Okay. To everybody right here in the audience, can we get a countdown? In 3, 2, 1, no. Go! So, welcome everybody to Final Fantasy 1 for the PlayStation Portable. Now, right off the bat, you're going to be seeing these guys buy a hammer, and that seems like a bit of a weird choice. But they're going to be setting up an equipment glitch right at the start, which is going to give us quite some overpowered equipment from the very start of the game. Basically, what they're going to be doing is they're going to be switching from a weapon slot into an armor slot. At the same frame, they go into the menu, and as a result, they're going to be able to, or they're going to load in the items they have in the weapon slot, but they're going to load them in their armor. They're also going to get one additional one so that they can sell that for some money. And they're going to get a whole bunch of heal items. So yeah, a good couple of potions, some antidotes, Phoenix Downs, and with that, they're going to be moving out of town. And, we're going to be talking to the king. And the king, he tells us that the princess, she got kidnapped by the evil knight Garland. And she's been taken into Chaos' shrine, and he asked us to save her. Since we are the Warriors of Light. Basically, the story of the game goes that the world has been in a bit of grief. The seas have been raging, the land has been rotting, and the only ones, according to legend, able to stop that are the four Warriors of Light, four youths, each with a small crystal. And what they need to do is they need to find the four crystals. They need to relight the four crystals. And what that will allow them to do is to travel back in time, 2,000 years into the past, to fight the evil Chaos, which is actually Garland. So we'll be seeing Garland very soon again. And they'll be defeating him, breaking a time loop, and, it's basically saving the world. Now, as we enter Chaos' shrine, you might see that we're not immediately going for the boss. Instead, we're going to get this leather cap. And basically what we did earlier with the equipment glitch, we're going to just do again. And we're going to glitch the leather cap into the weapon slot, which is going to give us the Judgment Staff, which is the most powerful staff in the game, with the side ability to cast Flare, the strongest black magic spell in the game. So, we're about, 2 minutes in, 3 minutes in, and we've got the most power, or one of the most powerful pieces of armor, I believe third most expensive piece. We've got the most powerful staff in the game, and we have the ability to cast the most powerful black magic spell in the game. Looks like Indy is taking a very small lead, going into the Garland fight slightly before Zeta is, but we're basically still tied at this point. That Gigas Worm encounter kind of wrecked our end on the Garland area, but that's all good. This fight can either be a 3-hit or a 4-hit fight, after which it's basically just that. That's the first boss of the game. That's all there is to it. And with that, we've got the princess saved, and it's time to move on to the king again. And he is going to royally reward us by building a bridge. And that might seem kind of dumb, but that's basically what we're going to be doing. They're going to be building a bridge so that we can kind of progress. The idea is, we'd like to get a ship so that we can actually move around a little bit, because we're fairly limited here. But the thing is, there's no ships here, but there's supposedly one in Provoca. So by building the bridge, we can move over to Provoca and get ourselves that ship. The princess also rewards us with the loot, and that is an item we will be seeing again over the course of this run. But it'll be a while. Around the 1 hour 25 mark, roughly, we'll be seeing that loot again used in the final dungeon of the game. Now, as we get into the bridge cutscene, I quickly want to point out the guy in the bottom left. Pay specific attention to this guy. You'll see all the guards working really, really hard on getting this bridge fixed. But then there's the guy in the bottom left just slowly waving his arm, not really doing anything.
Basically, this guy in the corner is your team, and the rest of the guys are we?
I think you might have gotten the teams confused there.
No,
I think
I'm pretty sure it went that way.
Anyway, once we've got that out of the way, we're going to be moving on to the bridge. And you'll be noticing that as we do, we're going to get into a cutscene. Now, this cutscene is only skippable in the PSP version of the game. It's kind of a neat little side thing that for just this version, you can actually skip all of the cutscenes by just mashing through them. Every other version of the game will not allow you to do this, and it would be about a minute and a half long cutscene, so it's kind of nice that we can actually just completely skip it. No worries. So yeah, we're going to be moving on to Provoca, and you might have noticed that that Indy purposely skipped a couple of tiles down, and this is mostly to avoid a little bit of forest. The thing is, the forest tiles actually have a higher likelihood of giving you an encounter than plain tiles or swamp tiles do. As such, you want to be avoiding the forest as much as you can, unless you really have to take a lot of additional steps for it. The general idea simply being that, you know, the fewer encounters you get, the fewer time you'll waste. All of the encounters are random, as well as your chances to run away from them being random. So it's kind of like trying to balance it out. It looks like we may have lost signal on one of the two games. We're hopefully going to get that fixed. We might want to pause it here just for a little bit. We're going to get that set back up. We'll just quickly wait until we've both got a screen again, because our opposing team does not.
No.
May I real quick, Andy?
This button, right?
Yeah, come, just... Okay, so we should have output on here, but it looks like...
There we go.
Okay, how about we just get on the same tile and keep moving from there, because we were just about even anyway.
Yes.
Are we ready to keep on going? Okay, we'll wait a little longer. So yeah, I guess this is our general first run of the marathon luck. It's all good though. We'll get it sorted out and then we'll just keep moving. We've got plenty of games where I know that our estimates have been fairly wide for a lot of them. So we should and we have a little bit of a buffer right after this run as well. So we should be completely fine in that sense. Yeah, it was really the couple encounters that they got compared to us that made them run ahead a little bit, and then some technical issues on their side that made them run behind again a little bit. But, you know, let's just keep it slightly fair and just start the race here, basically.
Yeah.
It's all good. We're just going to start the race 6 minutes and 1 second and move on from there.
Easy world record.
Now, I should quickly mention, the way that we balanced out the teams is actually kind of interesting in that... Box and Zeta are roughly on the same skill level. Box is a little bit better than Zeta. So, you know, we figured we'd tie them in such a way that, you know, Indy is with Box, whereas, you know, Box and Indy, or Indy and me are roughly on the same level as well, whereas I'm slightly better. It looks like we're just about ready to get back started. 3, 2, 1, go! Let's go, boys! So here we go again. We've managed to get into Provoca despite all the issues, and we're going to get into a fight with some pirates, because it turns out that the one ship that there is right here actually has been captured by a couple of pirates. And you'll notice these runners, they'll opt to use the Judgment Staff. And the Judgment Staff, as a side effect, has the ability to cast Flare. Now, unfortunately, on our end, we're going to get a lot of attacks from the pirates, whereas on Indy's end they do not, so they get back their lead that they had. It's only a minor one, though. Everything can still change, of course. And now that we have that, we're going to be moving on to get ourselves a ship. And while we do, you're welcome to do a quick donation.
We have a 1 euro and 2 cent donation from Shadow Wolf, saying the donation count made me nervous like always. Thank you, Shadow Wolf.
So yeah, we're going to get onto the ship, and once we get onto the ship, we've got a good bit of sailing ahead of us. Now, the sailing can make or break any run, because the encounters on the sea are not fun. There's pretty much any encounter that isn't a buccaneer can just completely wreck you. There is Sahagins, which are basically the wolves of the land, or the wolves of the sea, which is just incredibly hard to run from. There's some sharks, which you saw on Box's and Indy's end. We've got big eyes, which can paralyze you and are a pain to run from. They're just bad all around, and you know, getting those kind of encounters can just lose you a lot of time. Now, once they're back on land, we've got a giant walk through a lot of forest coming up. You'll notice at some point they're going to be healing all of their party members, mostly in making sure that they have the health to be able to get through to the crown section. There is a boss there where if you didn't heal at all and all four, and you get a pack of four, they all four attack before you do just about anything, you will die. So you'll notice they will use a bunch of potions here. Now, one thing you can do with the potions is you just mash through them, and by mashing through, you actually cancel out the animation, which speeds us up just a little bit. It's one of those little time saves along the way that you can get. Now, what happens story-wise here is that, you know, we now have our ship, so you think, okay, we need to get to the Four Crystals, which is what we're going to be doing, but the thing is, the sea that we're currently in, and that our ship is currently in, is in no way tied to the sea which we would need to get into in order to get to one of the crystals. In order to get there, we need to blow up a canal, which the dwarves are actually working on. They're working on getting that canal fixed. The thing is, in order to finish that up real quick, they need the nitro powder, which is actually in the starting town, but the king was too greedy to give it to us. So in order to open up the door, we need the Mystic Key. Now, the Mystic Key we can quite easily find, actually, in that it's held by the elves. The Elven Prince has such a key. The thing is, the Elven Prince is kind of under a sleeping curse right now, and so we need to find a way to wake him up, which is not a big deal, because Matoya can actually brew us a Jolt Tonic, which will immediately wake him up from this curse. The problem is she's gone blind because she's missing her eye, the Mystic Eye, or the Crystal Eye, either way works, the other runner quickly correcting me on that. The Crystal Eye, which is currently held by the Dark Elf Astos, who wants to become the true Elven Prince and rule over all of the elves. Now, he will not fight us unless we give him the crown, because with both the eye and the crown, he will be able to get ultimate power. So, you know, we pick up the crown to go over to Astos, give that to him so that we can get the eye, bring that eye all the way to Matoya so that we can then get the Jewel Tonic, bring that to the Elven Prince, get the Mystic Key, go over back to the starting town to get the Nitro Powder, go over to the dwarves, blow up the canal, and from there on we can finally move on to the first crystal. So yeah, we've basically got a giant fetch quest for like the first 20 minutes of the run. In the meantime, Box and Indy pretty much taking care of the Bisco Demons, picking up that crown and moving over to Astos. In the meantime, Zeta already at Astos, he's gotten a bit of a better encounter luck here. You'll notice over the course of the run, especially in the early game, a lot here is determined just on your encounter luck. If you get better encounters, it just saves you a ton of time. And if you get unlucky, it can lose you a lot of time. They got two encounters on the sea, whereas Zeta got none. The fight with Astos is a pretty straightforward fight. We attack with both the Thief and the Warrior, and then use the Judgment Staff with both of the Mages. The thing with this fight is, Astos has a spell called Death, and if he targets one of the Mages, there is a chance he will not get a one-turn cure. In an old route of the game, we actually used to get a sword in the first town, and use that. After that, we switched to, you know, just using the four Judgment Staffs, but that would result in a two-turn fight, which is not really ideal. And then this this was one of the strats that I actually found, to use the Judgment Staff to make it a pretty much guaranteed one-turn fight, and still speed it up quite a bit at the end. So, Zeta now getting the Crystal Eye, Indy saving before Astos, taking the safe route there, and starting up the fight with Astos, so he's not too far behind. We're looking at very small differences here. Both of these runners getting a pretty decent time for this first segment of the game. And now they're just going to be walking back to the ship, going all the way back to the starting town to get back to Matoya, which they're going to be using to get that Jolt Tonic. And this is just basically going to be a whole lot of questing around. So while we do, I'm going to quickly ask our host, Sniper. Sniper, how about you tell us some more of our cause? Because I feel like you know, we glossed over it pretty quickly during our announcements. So how about you tell us some more?
We are an initiative to benefit the Dutch Cancer Society, a society to help the prevention of cancer, the research towards preventing cancer, and getting patients the best help they need.
Yeah, thank you, Sniper. So yeah, I mean, it's cancer research is always a great place to put your money towards. So, you know, there's quite some incentives coming up, so be sure to donate for those as well. Zeta now almost back at Matoya, now getting the bad encounters on the sea, specifically the sharks. Now, the thing with the sharks and with a lot of early sea encounters is we don't really have anything that will help us run away from enemies. So we're basically just going to have to beat through. We're just going to keep on praying that we run away, but if it takes too long, you can opt to just kill them. Which, it's really looking like we're losing a lot of time on this shark. This shark is not letting us go today. So let's see if we can we can get rid of it. So yeah, that makes quick work of it. You ideally want to just try to run from it, because running away is generally faster than killing it. But especially with enemies like those sharks, it can be quite a pain. You'll have noticed that Zeta actually parked his ship on the leftmost tile of that dock. There's actually two strats you can take here. You might be seeing a different one on the end of Indy and Box. The thing is, the docks do not actually spawn any encounters, but the ship moves a little bit faster. So you can opt to save a couple of frames by parking on the rightmost tile, or you can opt to play it a little safer and, you know, just make sure you can't get any encounters on those two tiles by taking the leftmost tile, which is, it's kind of runner preference which you go for. You see runners generally do either. I think most of them will go for parking on the right, but the differences are very minor, and you know, if you were to get an encounter, it will definitely have been slower than if you didn't. But if you did get an encounter, or if you wouldn't have gotten an encounter, it would have been faster to take a ship. You may have also noticed that the brooms that were in Matoya's cave just now, those brooms are actually a really big, or can actually really be a big issue, in that the broom can actually get stuck in the door. It's very, very unlikely to happen, but I want to give a quick shout out to Ausabe, a French runner of this game, who has actually once lost the world record to the broom. He ended like a couple seconds away from the world record run, but the thing he lost like 20 seconds on was a broom getting stuck in the door. It's very unlikely to happen, but we have seen it in the past. Zeta getting probably one of the worst possible ambushes out there. The Sahagin Big Eye pack. Indy also not quite getting the luck on the encounters. I've seen a couple of ambushes on his end as well. Definitely been a pretty unfortunate race for both teams so far. Zeta still having a bit of a lead, but with encounters like this, Indy quickly catching back up by a good margin.
And this is the interesting thing about FF1, anything can happen, so even Zeta's currently ahead, we have still plenty more dungeons, and we also have some unrunnable encounters late in the game.
Yeah, later on we'll be running into certain encounters you just cannot run from, and that's where execution will start playing a big part on the runners as well. Because trying to run away from an unrunnable encounter can lose you quite a lot of time. We'll see how, well, it's mostly up to Box and me in that case, how we'll be able to deal with these encounters. Another Sahagin Big Eye combination, so another one that Zeta is going to have to kill. And with that, Box is, or Indy is pretty much catching up right then and there. And then, as soon as I say that, getting the 5-encounter ambush on the goblins. Goblins luckily not being one that's very hard to run from, but definitely still kind of annoying to get. So Zita making quick work of the Sahagins using the Judgment Staff. And he's going to be moving on to the Elven Castle. So he's just about to get the Mystic Key. Now, generally, you'll want to get the Mystic Key somewhere between the 16 and 17 minute mark. For really good runs, you want to go under 16. Which I think I've seen as low as about a 1450-ish. Which would require pretty insane encounter luck. Anything under about the 18 minute mark is what you'd expect on the good level runners, which I mean, both of these guys are definitely on the level that they should be getting a sub 18, unless they really get trolled. And it looks like Indy has definitely gotten to the point where he's gotten trolled quite a bit. Zita picking up the Mystic Key. And with that, he's going to leave the castle, but immediately re-enter, and he's going to get the Mithril Hammer. We've still been running around with the Knight's Armor, and though that gives really solid defense, it doesn't actually help us with running away. So what he's going to do is he's going to get the Mithril Hammer, and he's going to be glitching that into the Thieves' Armlets. Each Thieves' Armlet gives a +5 you don't need to re-equip the Judgment Staff, by the way. But each Thieves' Armlet gives a +5 on agility, adding for a total of +15 on agility, which will make running away from encounters significantly easier. This is also, like, these menus, you'll notice that these are one of the trickier parts of the run. Switching between the two screens is actually frame perfect. It basically comes down to pressing two buttons at the same frame. But considering how small the window is, it can be a little bit tricky to get, especially for the somewhat less experienced runners. So he goes into Elfheim, and once he gets into Elfheim, he's going to buy some gold needles. And we technically don't need these, and if you would go for a perfect time, you wouldn't be getting them. The thing is, they will help a lot in terms of safety for the next couple of dungeons, so we'll definitely want to have them anyway. And with that, Zita is going to be moving on to finally get this Nitro Powder. You'll notice Indy a little bit faster on the menuing. He unfortunately got a drop earlier on, which actually makes this a little bit trickier. Looks like he's having a little bit of trouble with the menu right now. The Crystal Mail is not one you normally have. You get that if you get the sword drop from Astos, which is actually a very uncommon drop, which is very useful for a glitchless run, but not at all for the glitched run. So it actually will hinder his menuing quite a bit in that sense. Luckily, the White Mage can't equip it, so we won't be seeing that from the end of the White Mage. So, once we get into this castle right here, back to Cornelia, there is actually a slight route change you can take. There is a somewhat different route. It's not necessarily faster, but on average it would be a little bit faster. Where you can get an item in here and glitch that into, I believe, the Black Robes, which will cast Blazara, which is going to make some unrunnables later on a little easier. We can use the Judgment Staff, but the thing is that the Judgment Staff has a bit of a longer animation on it. So you don't ideally want to use that. You can basically opt for two strats on that. You can either just not get that item, save a little bit of time, and pray you don't get the unrunnables. Or you can get that item and, you know, play it a little bit safer. I think both of the runners will be going for the slightly older route, which is technically, like, on average slower, but can also be faster in a sense. It's a bit of a weird route change. It's actually very recent, and another German runner, Nikki Nowell, she actually worked a lot on getting little optimizations like that to be able to make the game a lot more consistent over the course of a run. None of these additions are required or make the run any less deadly, because there are still some encounters that will kill you regardless of whether or not you have those items. And then in general, the run is already pretty safe and pretty consistent as it is, so it doesn't really make a big difference if you don't go for it. But certain newer runners will definitely go for that. It's really a runner choice in that sense, whether you'd go for a slightly safer route or a slightly more high-risk, high-reward kind of route. So as we blow up the canal, we're going to get another one of those cutscenes. We're mostly going to be able to skip through that, and that's going to open up the sea so that we can finally go towards Melmond, which is where we can get into the Cavern of Earth, where we're going to be getting our first crystal. Now, we can basically get all of the crystals in any order we want. We can choose which ones to go for, with one exception, and that is that the first crystal has to be the Crystal of Earth. So both of these runners will be going for that. By the time we're going to get to the other crystals, we'll already have switched runner. So Box and me will be going for the fire, wind, and water crystals. Not specifically in that order. Try to not break my PSP, by the way, Zeta. I'd very much appreciate if I can still run on that at a later point. Anyhow, with that being said, it is about time we're going to get a bit of an equipment upgrade, because even though we've upgraded our armor just now to help us run away from enemies, we have yet to upgrade our weapons. And we're still using a staff, and this is a very, very good staff, and normally you'd only be getting it in one of the bonus dungeons by beating Atomos in Lifespring Grotto. The thing is, staffs are not particularly well known for being good at physical damage. And since physical damage is going to be our main source of damage output, we really don't want to be using that for the entirety of the run. So what we will be doing is, once we get to Melmond, we'll be picking up the Steel Globe, and we can actually glitch that into a sword, which is the most powerful sword in the game. Now, you may have heard of such weapons as Excalibur, you know, pretty strong weapon, pretty legendary weapon to have, especially in a lot of RPGs where you're supposed to, this is supposed to be one of the best items you can get. Yeah, we're going to be getting a sword that has about three times the base power of Excalibur. Excalibur having a base power of 45, and this one having a base power of 125. If that wasn't enough yet, this weapon, on top of all that, has the ability, or grants you a strength boost of 15, making you even more overpowered than you already were. Now, we can only equip it from the warrior, so, you know, we're going to have to unequip one. Luckily, the warrior can naturally equip it. Normally, you'd only be able to get this from Chronodia, the biggest, or the toughest version of Chronodia, for that matter, the super boss of this game. It's a boss that you really only see in the PSP version of the game. It might be on iOS and the likes, but I'm not really sure if it's in there. And Chronodia has, like, 8 different forms, and we're going to be trying to get the toughest form of those 8 forms. So you can probably imagine that this is definitely a really, really difficult boss to go for. By this point, by the way, due to the unfortunate encounter with the Big Eyes, as well as Indy being a little bit more experienced with the menus than Zeta, is Indy now taking a slight lead over Indy. Sita. Wow. We'll be heading into Cavern of Earth, where we're pretty much going to be making our first safety save in a little bit. The Cavern of Earth is one of those dungeons that is notorious for a lot of runners. Most runners really do not like this dungeon too much. It's the first place where you're going to be seeing unrunnable encounters. It's the first place where you're going to be seeing an encounter that could actually legitimately kill a run and wouldn't be all that unlikely. So likely Zeta, once he enters B3, is going to take a safety save, might even heal up the mages, depends on whether he opts to go for that or not. He's going to be moving on to the next boss. Once we get to the next boss, I can show you why, or we'll be able to show you why this sword is so incredibly powerful. Unless we get the Pisco Demons, in which case, you know, they're just going to kill it anyway. So we'll get to see, you know, this was a boss earlier on in the game. And this is also why this is currently unrunnable. The developers were a little bit lazy, and they decided, you know what, we'll just go for an encounter, or the mini-boss earlier, and we'll not want to have that runnable, because you don't want people to run away from bosses. So what they did is they just made it unrunnable throughout the entire game. There's a couple encounters like that. For the PSP version, it's the only one you'll encounter. Another Pisco Demon, pretty unlucky there. Indy making his first, second safety save, actually.
Actually, the third.
The third, even?
Yeah.
Okay. But yeah, Indy making another safety save as well. There's the Cockatrices, which Indy just got. Luckily for him, preemptive, but they can petrify on hit, and that makes them so dangerous. Zeta getting to the vampire. This is a boss fight, just watch. Boss still trying to pull something out, but yeah, that was the boss. That's come again?
You blinked and it's
over. Yeah, it's literally at the blink of an eye, it's done. He's going to get the Star Ruby, and that's actually a very important item, and there have been runners that have forgotten that item in the past, and it really loses you a lot of time if you forget that. We would go for the Crystal of Earth. The thing is, there is a stone slab in the path, and we can't really cross that, so we can't go further into the dungeon. With that being said, there is a way to get rid of it, and that's by getting the Earth Rod, which isn't too bad to find. There is a sage in the sage's cave that will just give us the Earth Rod. The problem is, there is this this giant in the way, and you know, we all know that giants like rubies, so we're gonna give him the Star Ruby to, you know, make sure he isn't too hungry. He gets out of the way so we can get to the Earth Rod. Generally, for races and marathon runs like this, you're looking at a roughly 30-minute Earth Rod time as something you generally want to aim for. It looks like both of these runners are not really going to be too far off of that. An average walk out of the Cavern of Earth is about a minute 45 to 2 minutes. But that can vary quite widely from time to time, depending on what encounters you get. I've seen Earth Caves where it took me like 4 minutes to walk out. I've even had it before that which was actually in a tournament match. That, you know, you just get paralocked and you just lose like 8 minutes or something. I had that in my last tournament match against, I believe, Solomus? I'm not really sure. No, not against Poor Scythe. No, it was my match after Leonis. Anyway, I got paralocked there, lost a lot of time to that, and that basically can lose you the race right then and there. There's a few encounters that can do that, so, you know, they're definitely a major issue when you're looking at the Cavern of Earth. So Zeta, making it his way into the Giant's Cave, gets to the Giant, and, you know, since he has the Ruby, not a big deal. He's going to let Zeta pass. Indy, on the other hand, getting a quite unfortunate walk out of Cavern of Earth so far. Definitely not the kind of walk you generally want to have. And this is definitely where it shows, you know, FF1 can do just about anything to you. If it really wants you, you will just not get through anytime soon. Generally, it tends to kind of even out over the course of a run, but it can make quite a difference. The Shadow Ambush right here, being quite an encounter to mention as well, Shadows actually can only ever be a preemptive or an ambush, and it's about an 80% to be preemptive. The general rule of the thumb, at least for what we say, is, you know, if you get a Shadow Ambush, it means the game hates you. And, you know, that definitely goes to show what just happened. Zeta getting the Earth Rod pretty much at the 30-minute mark, so he's roughly on a very average pace for races. Indy just getting blocked time and time again, and really being slowed down here by the Cavern of Earth. Not to say it's done yet, because there is the Cavern of Ice, and there is the third time that you go through the Cavern of Earth, and there is plenty other dungeons in the late game as well that can completely make or break a run here. So now that we have the Earth Rod, Zeta is going to make his way back towards the Cavern of Earth, and now we can actually start going for the first of the four crystals. It really would be about time, you know, considering we all said we would try and beat this game in about an hour and 40 minutes, and we have yet to get our first crystal, and we're already, you know, about a third in. But we are now finally making our way to the Cavern of Earth, and we're going to be getting the Crystal of Earth. The reason you need this one first is in order to get the canoe, which is an item we need to get into several other dungeons later on, we'd need to have at least one crystal, otherwise the sage, he's not going to actually give us the canoe. So, you know, we need to prove our worth, which seems fair. The boss of this dungeon, by the way, being pretty much one of the deadliest bosses in the entire run. So you'll notice that over the course of this dungeon, both of these runners will be making at least 2 safety saves. One at the start of B3 in case he gets some more cockatrices, and then one before the lich fight. There is a way to make sure that you will not die against the lich, which is by getting a dragon meal in the elven town, which a very old route of the game actually used to do. The thing is, you know, glitching an additional item and losing some agility really isn't worth the about like 10% chance that Lich will actually kill you. On average, a safety save is a significantly better choice in that sense, because on average, you just save so much more time to that. So it looks like Indy now also getting the Earth Rod. It means that we're at about a 2 minute difference, roughly. That is definitely a difference that can be completely negated over the course of one dungeon. A 2 minute difference does not have to mean a thing, and this eight encounter ambush will definitely help a little bit in that. But you know, we kind of like to have a little closer a race, so. It's not a major issue if Indy manages to save a little bit of time on Zeta on this one. There's the cockatrices. Now, the reason we bought the gold needles earlier is if these cockatrices do end up petrifying a party member, like right there, we can opt to just use a gold needle and we'll get rid of the petrification. So yeah, that will have solved that. But if you didn't buy the gold needles, there is one gold needle right here in the dungeon that you can get. But at that point, you basically would lose as much time as getting the gold needles usually takes. So it doesn't really save much at the end of the day. The thing is, even though you get that or you have those gold needles, you're still hoping not to really get petrified, because the additional menus and stuff do still lose a good chunk of time if you have to do it a lot. So we use the Earth Rod here, we get rid of the Stone Slab, and with that we're moving on to B4. Now I quickly do want to mention, there is one encounter, I have yet to see it on either of these runners, but on both B3 and 4, we have the option to get an Ochre Jelly encounter. Now I'm not 100% sure if FFZ is currently on, but if it is, there is an Ochre Jelly emote. If we happen to get that encounter, be sure to spam that emote in chat. So Zeta currently on B4, I believe Indy being currently on B2. So they're really just only like two floors apart. Indy getting a little unlucky and getting a 6 Gorgoyle ambush. Zeta getting unlucky and getting the 4 Wraith ambush here. And Wraiths is definitely one of those other encounters that you really don't like to see. They have the ability to paralyze you. They're kind of hard to run from in general. They can just be a pain, but we'll see what happens. So looks like Indy has made his way to B3. Zeta now opting to go and kill off these wraiths. Opts to go for the sword. It's really one of those little things in the run that you'll notice. The sword animation is about, like, 3 sword animations is about the same length as 1 Judgment Staff animation. So if you get like 4, you can generally opt to go for the Judgment Staff, depending really on your position. If you know that your menu position is correct and you have to switch the menu twice, it might not be faster to opt for that. It's really kind of trying to balance little things like that. So Indy still getting punched in the face by some wraiths. Zeta now just about at the Lich fight. And like I said, this guy right here is pretty much the toughest boss out there. This is not an easy one to fight. Indy getting very unlucky on this one from the looks of it. He might opt to go for a Judgment Staff, yeah. But he might also get paralocked at this rate. Let's hope he does not. Does not get away, is going to opt for the Judgment Staff. Let's see if he actually will be able to get away with it. Zeta getting to the Lich, killing off the Lich in one go. So that is the Lich done. And Indy getting the paralock. This is a major, major time loss. How far back was the last save? Was that at the start of the floor or at the start of the dungeon?
I'm not sure.
Looks like one of his mages managed to break out. Let's hope he can actually get the Judgment Staff
off.
Come on,
listen. Do this.
These paralocks are pretty notorious in that the paralysis can actually stack. He gets the Judgment Staff off, so he's out of that encounter. It does lose a lot of time to get that, but at least he can keep pushing forward. Zeta now seeing the first of the 4 bonus dungeons unlocks, because every single time we get to one of the crystals, we'll note that one of these bonus dungeons is going to get unlocked, the first being right here being the Earthgift Shrine, which has the bosses of, or some of the bosses of Final Fantasy III in there. Each of the bonus dungeons pretty much has some bosses from other Final Fantasies that, you know, you can kind of go back and do those. You get pretty cool rewards if you actually beat them. Zeta getting an ambush with some ghouls and ghasts, and well, this could also be pretty bad. Let's see what happens. Two characters. Looks
wow.
Like...
I just have to mention that was a zero encounter before.
Ooh, and Zeta here getting away, barely dodging a Paralock himself. The zero encounter B4 definitely going to save Indy some time back, which is probably a good thing. Because we will definitely, you know, if we want to keep this a little close, then we'll definitely need to go for that. Zeta going for a bit of a heal on the warrior there. Generally, you want to keep the health of the warrior and the thief somewhere between like 25 and 75. Or 20 and 70, it kind of depends on the runner where you'll draw those lines. But his warrior having dropped to as low as 7 definitely seems like a good idea to heal here. Indy gets the quick kill on the Lich as well, does not get any struggles with that. And that is the first crystal down on both of these runners. Still about 2 minutes apart, so despite the Paralock, that encounterless B4 definitely seems to have saved Indy that time back again. Zeta now making his way to Crescent Lake, where we're going to get another equipment upgrade, because it's just about time we did, as well as going to be getting the canoe and some ethers. The ethers are mainly so that we can heal a little bit more easily later on, because we'll be using magic at some point. The canoe, which will allow us to enter 3 dungeons, so we can actually choose which one we want to do here, and we're going to get a Mithril Axe to help our running chances a little bit more. So Zeta getting his ethers. Now, I will note that as soon as you get the canoe, you basically have 3 routes that you can go. The game kind of intends you to go to Mount Gulk and get the second crystal, the Crystal of Fire. We're not going to do that, though, because once you have the airship, you can get to that dungeon significantly faster than without. So we'll want to wait for that just a little bit longer. You can go to the Citadel of Trials, which will help us get a class upgrade. There's an item there that we would need to get the class class change. Now, the thing is, in order to get the class change, you'd need to also have the airship, and we currently do not have that. So that's currently not an option either. However, I will note that in the glitchless run of this game, we would go there because of some equipment upgrades that we would find in the dungeon. Our third and last option is actually the one the game really doesn't actually seem to intend you to go to just yet, which is the Cavern of Ice. Which you'll notice that as soon as we enter it, we're going to get a very steep increase in difficulty. Zeta having a bit of trouble getting those Black Garb zombie, gets them on. The Black Garb's increasing the agility by 10 for each, giving a total of 30 of the 2 characters that do have it equipped. So that'll be a nice little bonus here. Now, as we enter the Cavern of Ice, you'll notice that very steep increase in difficulty, and this is, like, we need to go there in order to be able to get the airship, which, you know, is going to make moving around the world map significantly faster. However, there is a lot of stuff in that dungeon that can kill you. There is the 1 in 64, the White Dragons, which, if they use Ice Storm, you're just dead. There's just nothing you can do. There is some Dark Wizards, a 3 in 64 encounter, which have the ability to cast Faraga, which is basically, like, if you might survive 1 if you're lucky, but 2, you will definitely not survive. There is the Ice Gigas Winter Wolves, and Winter Wolves can do a lot of damage as well as that encounter being unrunnable. There's the Cockatrices, which form the major issue earlier on, which have the ability to petrify on hit, which basically means the character is dead at that point. There is the 6 and 64 Mind Flyers, which can kill a party member on hit, as well as paralyze the entire party with one go. I've only seen that happen once, but they can do that. And it's very, very common for them to kill or to paralyze like 2 or 3 party members in one turn. And then there is just a bunch of stuff like specters, wraiths, whites, ghasts that will paralyze you. There is the Pisco demons, which are unrunnable. Let's just say this dungeon is not fun. And that is quite an understatement in that one. Yeah, most runners, for most runners, this is the least favorite dungeon in the game, just because of how many bad things it can throw at you. Generally, runners will opt to safety save like 3 times over the course of a dungeon, 4 times, depending on the runner. Looks like Zeta getting very unlucky in getting a giant combination of wraiths and specters, pretty much getting paralocked with the exception of one character. So let's see if his black mage will be able to pull through. Does not get the run, so he will actually have to pray that he can get that judgment staff off. Luckily, the last two party members are actually significantly less likely to get hit. Basically, the way that it works in this game, they didn't really have any way to work with rows like you would normally. Like, you would normally put your warriors in the front row and your mages in the back row, and that would kind of even it out. The way that they worked around it with Final Fantasy 1 is that they made the chance to get hit for the first party member about 50%, at 125 out of 255. Then about a 25% for the second party member, and then about 12.5% for the last two party members. So this way, you know, your top two party members would actually get hit significantly more and will take a lot more damage than your lower two party members. I remember running this game before I actually knew that, and I used to play around with it a little bit, so I used to put like my white mage as the first party member, because then you'd see the white mage run over the world map, which is pretty cool. And then just getting so much damage on the white mage, whereas the warrior was just not taking enough damage. At the time, I thought it was just RNG, but then later on we figured out that it actually is, because this is a thing. And this has been a thing since the NES version. So it's one of those neat little things across all versions. This encounter right here, by the way, it's a spiked tile, so no matter how much you will walk onto this tile, you will always get the Spectre, Wraith, White, Ghast combination right here. So that can be a little annoying, so we'll see if Zeta can deal with it. In the meantime, Indy finally having made his way to the Cavern of Ice as well, and as we get towards the boss, we can do a quick donation.
We have a 5 euro donation from Rule 65 saying, Audio Guy OP. This goes towards naming the Madagascar file name Pongwong.
So in just a little bit, we'll be actually doing some grinding. And I know grinding is boring and it's slow, and we're speedrunners, we don't like to grind. However, the grinding specifically in this game will not be that bad. The thing is, because of our equipment, we don't really need any levels. We need some health, which is kind of nice for later on. But other than that, nothing will really become a big issue. We don't really have a lot of magic defense, but we're going to work on that later on. So that wouldn't really be the issue. The thing is, we want to get a couple of spells. There's 3 spells specifically that we want to get. There's Haste, Teleport, and Hilara. Hilara, which we need in order to be able to even survive the final boss. Haste, in order to basically double our damage. We're going to be using that for 2 fights. And then Teleport, which is going to save us having to do a couple of floors later on, which saves a little bit of time as well. In order to get that, we're going to be grinding both of these mages to level 19. Now, we still have to do a little bit after we get the airship, so we'll be leveling them to 18.5. So we'll be doing like up to 18 and then fight one more Evil Eye, get them to 18.5, and with that we can actually just move on and we should have enough. So this is the Evil Eye. It looks like Zeta is opting to take a little bit of a safety here in getting an extra level on both the Warrior and the Thief as well. That little stone on top there is the one thing we're basically here for. We need to pick that up over the course of this grind at some point. Most runners, you'll notice, will do that immediately after killing the first one. I'd imagine some just pick it up over the course of the run somewhere. Thundara is, by the way, the move we want to see here, because that will kill off the remaining party members. Some will actually pick it up at the end of the grind, which I've seen kind of screw people over when they're doing like random jobs or a bingo where they suddenly don't need that grind and then it just completely gets messed up. So yeah, as we go into the grind, it looks like Indy is not too far behind going into the grind. Gets a Mind Blast on a Mind Flyer, Let's see what happens here. This is just to show how bad that encounter can be. Gets away with it, and now also starting off that grind. Now, this grind actually had a lot of routing into it over the course of the routes that we've had. Originally, when I started this game about like a year and a half ago, this grind used to be about 8 minutes long, and we used to grind both the thief and the white mage, and the white mage had to get up to level 33 to get Hyulaga. Back then, we didn't do class change, so we skipped an entire dungeon. But it turned out there is an item in the citadel that will actually increase our intelligence by so much that we can skip a lot of grinding. It saves about 6 minutes worth of grinding. So Zeta now only needing one more, and then it's out of the dungeon. He's going to be healing up all of his party members, make sure that everyone is back up on his feet. Probably going to take another safety save so that he won't have to actually worry about dying at any point anymore. From this point on, dying in this dungeon becomes a lot less likely, but it's still very, very possible. And with that, he is going to be making his way to the airship, and once the airship has happened, that's when we'll be switching runners. Zeta getting pretty unlucky here in getting a 9-encounter ambush. Opts to go for a soft reset there. This is one of those little things that you'll notice a lot with races and marathon runs. If that encounter happens to be a 9-encounter ambush, it's generally faster to just reset and just try again. With that, it looks like Indy's also getting pretty close to finishing up the grind. He does still have to pick up the Levy Stone, but you know, that's a quick thing to grab. Zeta now getting away, and he's going to make his way out of the Cavern of Ice, after which we're going to go to the Ryukan Desert, where we'll finally get ourselves an airship. And while we make our way there, I'm going to throw it over to my good friend Sniper on the hosting station for a quick little donation.
And I would like some hype from the audience, because we have a 50 euro donation from Magnificent. Woo! Which says, 13 is a lucky number. Let's make this the luckiest BSG yet.
So it looks, if I'm not mistaken, and I'm again going to ask my host on this one, because I can't actually see it. But I think with that, we may have already surpassed the 100, haven't we? We have. Then I'd like the audience. Can we get a quick round of applause for that? Because we have.
Like,
I think
hype.
That is the fastest we have managed to raise 100 as it is. So
we did indeed.
Shout
Thank
outs to everybody to who already donated, and shout outs, of course, to the 50 euros because that is a massive donation. Zeta is now out of the Cavern of Ice. Indy is just about ready to make his way out as well. And that means very soon we'll be switching over between runners. Now, from that point on, I'm going to be throwing over the main commentating towards Indy, who's currently running. I'll keep it on, or I'll try to keep on, keep walking you guys through this, at least until we've actually made the switch. And, well, from there, it's on to the second half of the game, where, we're going to be trying to get the remaining 3 crystals and make our way to the final dungeon. So yeah, the Ryokan Desert, not actually too far away from where we originally already were. It's actually just a little bit south of Crescent Lake. And, looks like the cutscene is starting. So Zeta, thank you... first of all, thank you for the amazing job on the first half. Let's see if we can keep the lead over the second half.
Let's hope so.
Can we get a round of applause for Zeta?
Can we get a round of applause for Zeta for finishing the first half of the run? Looks like Indy is right behind us in making his way through the canal, after which he can too get himself an airship. And from this point on, movement is going to be a lot faster, and this is where you'll see why we actually want to get this airship as soon as possible. We can just fly over here real quick. I'm going to actually make a safety save because there is one encounter here that can kill me. It's a very unlikely thing to happen. It's only happened twice that I'm aware of. One time, by the way, being during the finals of the first tournament of the game. My opponent at the time, Lenefis, actually died there and got set back a whole lot to the start of Cavern of Ice. and that ended up losing him the race there. So, you know, we're going to take it safe there, take one extra safety save. And we're going to be making our way to the Citadel of Trials. Now, in general, there really isn't too much for that. And I quickly want to give a shout-out and a quick round of applause for Indy finishing the airship as well. I think we're at like a minute and a half difference, so you guys have caught up just a little bit still. Let's see if Box can try and even it out over the course of the second half. We're going to get into the Citadel of Trials, and this guy, he actually, in the NES version, requires you to show him the crown, but then later on the developers were like, yeah, that's required anyway, so we're just going to have you talk to them, and that'll do.
So yeah, both players, Cool is already in the Citadel, and Box is making his way. One thing we should mention, that there are two very important items we're going to pick up in the Citadel. One is the healing staff. We need to glitch the
Lordly Ropes, and the Lordly Ropes is actually what skips all of that grinding, because it's because of the Lordly Ropes that we get so much intelligence that Healara, a level 5 spell, will heal as much as usually would be Healaga, a level 7 spell. So it's quite a difference in that.
Yes. And the second item are the gauntlets we're going to use to glitch the golden staff, which also increases our intelligence and makes healing a bit more easy, especially for the final fight against Chaos.
So yeah, one little thing that threw me off right there in the menuing is Zeta doesn't actually sort his inventory, whereas I usually do. So the items were in completely different places from what I'm used to. This is kind of why, you know, the little things that make a relay race like this so different, but also as interesting as it is. That nightmare you just saw is actually on a spiked tile. We'll be fighting it twice. I actually got the 1 in 64 dragon zombie here. This is the rare encounter, and it's actually unrunnable.
Yeah, that's the healing staff.
And another ambush on the nightmares. I get a little unlucky and getting a double snort as well. That's just going to slow this down a little bit further. Looks like Box has made his way into the Citadel of Trials as well. So, Box, good luck on the second half, and may the best team win.
Which will obviously be Lava Boost.
Ooh, a 7 encounter mummy ambush. Now, these mummies can put me to sleep. They generally don't too badly, so we should be fine on this one. So the Citadel of Trials is one of those dungeons where it can either go really, really well or really, really poorly. The start of the dungeon, you'll notice that generally you don't get a lot of encounters, which Box actually didn't, and that's because every single time you warp, the danger level actually gets set back to 0, so your chances of getting an encounter early on are fairly low. The Mind Flyers, which is actually a pretty deadly encounter still, luckily got away from that. Gonna get myself the Rat's Tail over here. Now, story-wise, you're kind of supposed to find some item of proof, and it's basically what you expect to find. Why you'd expect to find a rat's tail in that, I have no idea, but apparently that's a thing. And
it takes balls to present a rat's
tail. Box makes a really good point in that it takes a lot of courage to present the tail of a rat to the king of all dragons, Bahamut. And I guess that's fair. I guess that would be a sensible explanation. Other than that, I really have no clue why we would need a rat's tail. But we're going to use that rat's tail to get the class change. And there's really one major thing that we're trying to look for in getting a class change. And that's the ability to learn a spell called Teleport, which is going to instantly warp us a floor back, which is very useful for two dungeons later on. Getting very unlucky on the encounters here, which is probably a good thing because it means Box can catch up a little bit, you know, make sure this stays a bit of a close race. It's kind of interesting because the swamp actually has one of the lower encounter rates of any overworld tile. I think the only one that's actually lower is the desert, and, you know, So getting all of this is quite interesting. So yeah, that walk out there compared to a pretty decent citadel from what I saw from Box's end definitely means that I'm going to be losing some time on Boxmeister on this one. We'll still have the lead, but we'll see how close we'll get.
Not for long.
And the trash talking continues, but oh well. So I enter the dragon caves here, and this is where we're going to meet up with the god of all dragons, Bahamut, or the king of all dragons, one of the two. And, well, we're going to present him the rat's tail, and as a proof for our courage, we're going to get the class upgrade. From this point on, my warrior will be a knight, which is basically a warrior that can also use a little bit of white magic. The thief will become a ninja, which actually is very significant because it allows for a lot more equipment. And both of the mages will become wizards, which is very useful as well.
On that note, we could mention, in the Any% route, the warrior is the only one who can actually glitch the barbarian sword. But as soon as you have a ninja, he can also equip the silver gloves? I don't know.
The steel gloves.
Steel gloves, yeah. Which you can use to skip the glitch the...
Yeah, basically, whenever you do something along the lines of, like, random jobs or something like that, it can be very useful to use a ninja rather than a warrior. Because if you still have a ninja, you'll at least know you can get the barbarian sword near the end of the run. Whereas on any other... anything other than a warrior or a ninja, you would not be able to get that. So generally in random jobs, you're hoping to get at least the one of the two. And if you don't, well, you'll have to find a way around it with dealing significantly less damage. There is actually a route. This hasn't been run yet, but it has been routed in such a way that for full bestiary, which would use three ninjas rather than two ninjas and replace the warrior. It's not actually been tested yet whether it's faster. We're suspecting that it very well might be. Never mind. I could have bought haste for the ninja there. I'm not used to my ninja being high enough level to actually even be able to get it, so... that kind of threw me off on that one. But this should still be fine. We have what we need.
Alright, and I think now it's time that we enter the second crystal dungeon. And you see that both runners try to run on the lava tiles as much as possible. The reason for that is they always take a hit when they walk on that, but there are no encounters on that. So this is basically lava boost FF1 style.
Yeah, so, I mean, as we're lava boosting, we might as well give a quick shout out to our boy #blamehim3. Doing the lava boosts in Super Mario 64, which is where that meme originated.
Lava boost.
The lava boosts. But yeah, as a result of that, we can both get through this dungeon very quickly. We do need to kind of keep an eye on our health because of encounters like that Fire Hydra right there, where if you don't heal up and you're all on one health, you can die on that, and that is a very big issue. On average, for the PSP run, you expect to get either one or two encounters over the course of this dungeon. If you get it, like in other versions, and if you get unlucky, it might end up being a little bit more. But that's generally what you're aiming for. Now, for your general race or marathon run, you're hoping to get at least a sub-1 Merilith. It looks like we're both not very far off of that, so we should still be completely fine. See, a Merilith, technically a boss that in the old boss's run, you can actually one-shot her. If you get a critical from the ninja in that run, you have a chance of just getting a one-shot. She's got 1410 health, and with a crit, the ninja... you need a crit and a high roll, and it has to be the ninja, but it's not impossible. I've seen it happen twice. It's very unlikely, but it's pretty cool when you just one-shot one of the major bosses of the game.
So, Box almost at the final floor, so both teams are very close to each other.
Yeah, despite of how apart it went at the start for a bit, it's definitely starting to even out quite a bit over the course of this run. And this just goes to show how much can happen over the course of a run of FF1. Box about to start his boss fight, whereas, you know, I'm just finishing up the boss, basically, and getting myself out of this dungeon. And with that, well, it's time to do a little bit more side questing. We've basically got all of the side quests out of the way, which is why we, like, got our airship, we got our class change. But the one thing we have yet to do is, well, there, we kind of need... Our next destination is the Sunken Shrine, which, as the name indicates, is a sunken shrine. It's underwater, and, you know, we're not particularly good at breathing underwater. So we're going to get this fairy right here, and she's going to be she's going to allow us to get the Oxyale, which is going to allow us to breathe underwater. There is an unrunnable encounter in this area, by the way. It's pretty unlikely to happen. That's an ogre-mage-hellhound combination. It's one of the lesser-known unrunnables, because you don't really see that one often over the course of a run. But yeah, as soon as we enter Gaia, we see the fairy unlock. In both the PSX version and the NES version, you actually have to unlock it manually. And I believe in the PSX version, it's faster to unlock it as you're pretty much at the lake in the back of town, rather than right there at the start. So we walk all the way around town. Now, the exit of this place is just on my right. It's a very quick walk. However, we will not be exiting out by walking. Instead, we're going to use teleport for the first time of this run. And we're going to teleport out of this dungeon. Or out of this town, I mean. Now, the reason for this being is that teleporting is about as fast as walking out. So it wouldn't really matter, but it said it sets up a menu for later on, for in the Sunken Shrine, where we're going to actually be using teleport again. So because of that, it saves a little bit of time, be it a very minor little time save.
We saw that Box just bought a fairy, and additional to the fairy that we buy in the Desert Caravan, we also buy some Giant's Tonics, which increase our maximum health, and these can be very useful at the final boss, because we want the Black Mage and the Ninja to be at least 255 health for the final boss fight, and if they are not, then we definitely want to use some of these Giant Tonics to increase the health.
Yeah, basically, to make the fight safer. Basically the Giant Tonic increases your max HP by 200. For the course of one fight. So for most places, it wouldn't really be too useful because it's a one-time use. But for something as difficult as the final boss, they can be a major safety bonus. Generally, like it kind of like where the cutoff specifically is depends a little bit on the runner. Personally, I look at about like 275 for the ninja and about 250 for the black mage. But like I said, it depends really on the runner where he cuts that off. Some runners will go a little bit lower and, you know, go a little bit more risky. Some runners will go a little bit higher and, you know, play it a little safer. It's really just the way that you want to play it. Now, on a very, very rare circumstance, if the white mage happens to not have a lot of health either, you can also opt to use a giant tonic on the white mage. I've actually done that in a few runs at some point, and that can actually save a lot of time as well. So Box getting the unrunnable hellhounds. This one doesn't particularly look unrunnable because it's just a hellhound, and hellhounds on their own are runnable. The thing is, it is the hellhound ogre mage combination, just with zero ogre mages in it. So the game still flags it as unrunnable. I'm getting particularly unlucky on running away from these things. I have only been getting runnables, but they've still been very slow. Game, can you please?
And the Sunken Shrine is very famous for its unrunnables, because we have three encounters. We have the Zag and Prince and Chief combination, which are, I believe, almost every time 9.
Yeah, there's always 9 of those, and they are pretty much the worst possible encounter to get.
Then we have the Water Elementals, and we have the Ghosts, and if you get a lot of these encounters, it is very, very slow. Speaking about the encounters, on that floor you don't get any encounters, which is luckily for us.
This floor is basically like the town of the mermaids, so you know, they don't get encounters there. The only item we really want to get there is the Rosetta Stone, which is going to allow us to learn any language really, really quickly, which we'll need later on in order to be able to get to the Air Crystal. And on that note, like, you kind of, for a speedrun route, you'll pretty much always do the Sunken Shrine before, and the Water Crystal before the Air Crystal, because you need to get into this dungeon anyway in order to even be able to access the Flying Fortress. This encounter luck has been pretty bad so far, not gonna lie. Definitely losing more time on box just on that. The Sunken Shrine is one of those dungeons where you can get, like, pretty much no encounters at all, and you can get, like, a bunch of them, and it's really just praying that you don't get a lot here. I've been kind of lucky in that I haven't gotten a lot of unrunnables, at least, and I got a really good stretch there. Speaking of unrunnables...
And while Box making his way to Kraken and fighting this encounter, there's another equipment glitch coming up where we glitch the lightning axe into survival vests, and you're gonna see that we glitch the lovely ropes into the white mage, so we have some more intelligence for the later boss fights. So, and you see that Kool is equipping the lovely ropes only on the helmet and the glove slot. The reason for that is if you equip the lovely ropes on the armor slot, then the white mage actually have a regen animation, which is obviously slower, and we want to prevent that. And it seems Box is right behind, now at the almost at the menu.
I just got a really weird sound glitch, by the way. My sound effects are still playing, but everything else is not. And this is actually the very uncommon version that actually does save time. You'll see very soon why. We have no idea what causes this, but if we could purposely trigger this, this would save, like, 20 seconds. And even getting it now, it saves, like, a good 10 seconds at least. Basically, from this point on, my audio will literally only have sound effects. Because for some reason, it can't load in any other music. And that will cause stuff like the jingle after obtaining a key item not to play, which completely skips that, which saves a good couple of seconds. I've only ever seen this happen once in a run of my own, and I've heard of it happening like two or three times. But assuming you guys have Box's audio, you'll probably not be able to hear it, but from this point on, my audio will not have a lot to hear or to listen to anyway. They're actually hearing my audio, then...
Which is now gone.
Which is now gone and will not return for the entirety of the run. Yeah, you might want to switch the two over in that case. But yeah, just to show it off real quick, this is something that I wouldn't say it's never happened, but it's pretty close.
Did it ever happen in a marathon?
I don't think it's ever happened in a marathon. I only know of it happening in one run of my own, and I think Chrono or Double once had it.
I know it happened in the tourney.
It did happen in the tourney?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, but the complete removal. You hear, like, there is a sound glitch, which is not uncommon, which removes the audio temporarily, but completely removing it from the entirety of the game, that's a combination that you don't very often see.
At least one Final Fantasy with a good audio glitch.
Yeah, this is a very useful audio glitch. I will note that I don't know what would be what would happen if this would happen in a glitchless run. That would probably spark up quite the discussion, because there's, as far as we know, nothing within our control that influences this. I don't mind it because it's faster, but it's just weird. Anyway, as Box is killing the Kraken and gets his third crystal, I'm making my way through Waterfall Cave, which is actually where we're going to be getting another key item. That was not me.
I did not.
Okay. Anyway, we're gonna be getting the Warp Cube, which is an item we need in order to warp from the Mirage Tower, which is our next dungeon, into the Flying Fortress, which is where we're gonna be finding the Air Crystal. So that's something we'll need to look for, and we'll need to get that. We'll also get another equipment bit. We're gonna get ourselves a ribbon, which in turn we're gonna be glitching back in, or we're gonna glitch into a Gigantax, and then from there back into a ribbon, in order to grant us a lot of magic defense. Basically, every ribbon grants a 50% resistance against every single elemental type of magic. As well as giving immunity to pretty much every single status effect in the game. It's a very useful item. We don't get to use it very early on, because there's really only two places where you can get it. This is, by the way, what I mean. Like, the entire jingle there just didn't play, and that makes that quite a bit faster. So we're going to get that into the Gigantax, and we're going to equip the ribbons into the shield slot. Now, you may have noticed I didn't actually equip anything into the shield slot earlier. That's because most items in the shield slot would actually hardlock the game if it tries to call up a defense animation. Because, you know, it has a piece of armor in there, so it tries to defend, but then the piece of armor doesn't exist, so the game gets confused and just completely hardlocks. However, the ribbon does actually correspond with an existing animation, so we're completely fine and we can equip it there. Which is kind of nice, because we can get all of those bonuses for basically free. And now with that, it's on to our last visit to the town of Melmond. We got that Rosetta Stone earlier on, and we're going to use that in order to get ourselves... to learn Lothenian, which is, you know, some forgotten language. It's basically a dead language at this point. But if we want to get the chime to enter the Mirage Tower, we need to have learned this language. It's really awkward seeing this with no sound effects, by the way.
Yep.
But yeah, there you can see, like, normally you have like a 4 to 5 second jingle playing after that, after you learn the language. I just skip that now. This is where this becomes weird and interesting, but kind of cool at the same time. If there is anybody out there interested in trying to look for what actually causes this, you know, I'd be happy to help you in getting you all you need, but we really just, we have no clue, and quite a few people have looked into it, but we can't seem to purposely trigger it. Now, as we're going to move over to the next town, we're actually going to... Well, we're going to be encountering... we have a high chance of encountering a lot of unrunnables. The walk towards Lufenia is probably one of the worst walks in terms of overworld out there. There's a lot of forest. It's a giant stretch that you have to cross. For some reason, you can't actually just park your ship right next to it. Even though, if you know the town a little bit, there's actually a giant green field that you should be able to park an airship on. But sure, got a pretty good walk on that one, so... welcome to NPC Hell. And they were actually pretty kind to me. Gonna get ourselves the chime, and again, you'll see pretty much the same thing. Like, normally a jingle would play there, but I can instantly warp out now.
What we just saw on Box End.
Yeah, you'll be getting that jingle on Box's End a couple of times, so you'll see what kind of massive difference that the sound glitch gives. But with that, it's basically on to the last few dungeons of the run. At this point, there's basically three dungeons left. We still have to go to the Mirage Tower, which we need in order to get into the Flying Fortress. We go through the Flying Fortress, get ourselves the Air Crystal, and from there on, it's on to the final dungeon of the game. Now, I will note Mirage Tower is well known for how many encounters it has. It tends to spawn a lot of encounters over the course of this dungeon. And it's just not even funny, usually. But we'll see whether we can get through this. Unfortunately, got an ambush there by the Were-Tigers. Box now going to make his way to Melmond, going to learn Lufenian as well, after which he can learn the language and finally enter, or get the chime and then finally enter this tower as well. There is a bit of a mini-boss at the end of the dungeon. It is a 1 in 64 to encounter regularly, which is the Blue Dragon. But we will be seeing at least one just before we warp into the Flying Fortress. Look, getting pretty lucky with all these Hellhounds. One thing I quickly want to mention here is that the Vampires, we have seen one of those already. Theoretically, if you were to encounter one of them, you would not be able to run from it. This cannot happen in any version after the NES version, but in the NES version, if you get one, it's unrunnable. If it's more, then you can just run away. This piece is still in the code. It still exists in this version, although they just patched it by just not ever giving you one vampire, which is a pretty easy fix for something like that. So yeah, that's the Blue Dragon out of the way, and on to the Flying Fortress. So yeah, it is at this point that the lead really starts to increase. Our good old friend Evil Eye gonna say hi again. I will note that my thief actually has a lot of health right now. I might not even need to Giant's Tonic him.
He's very good.
My White Mage, on the other hand, being really low, so I might need to give her a Giant's Tonic instead. So yeah, the Flying Fortress, 5 floors, all pretty straightforward floors. This is one of those dungeons where casually it's actually really cool because there is so much loot in here. Like, there are dozens of items that you can get, and the game really prepares you for that final dungeon. It kind of expects that after this you're going to move on to Chaos Shrine. You're gonna get put up against some of the toughest stuff out there. So it basically gives you everything you need. You can get the Adamantite, which can get you Excalibur. There is a lot of armor in here, even for the mages. There is a third ribbon. There's one in the Sunken Shrine, which we skipped earlier, the one we got, and then there is a third one in here. There's just a lot of money, because don't underestimate the power of money in a game like this. Basically, just everything you'd need to start setting up for the final stretch. Okay. Now, my co-runner already shouts it in my ear before I even got a chance to say it, but on this last floor, there is a 1 in 64 encounter, the War Mech. It is the highest experience-yielding encounter in the game. It's very, very hype when you get it, so if we get it, I want you all to spam War Mech in the chat. That also goes if Indy or a Box gets it. On average, you'll see it about once every 32 runs, so it's very uncommon. The Black Flan being the second rarest encounter, by the way. And that gets us to the fourth and last fiend, Tiamat, and the Crystal of Air. So Boxmeister now also starting to make his way up the tower, after which he too can hopefully get himself to that Air Crystal, after which he will too be able to go on to the final dungeon. Tiamat, not that difficult a fight. Generally, it's just a one-turn fight if you just go for physical attacks with everyone. On the newer route, the bit of a safer route that I mentioned at the start of this run, you'd actually not be able to one-shot him with physicals, and you need to use haste instead. We're going to see the last of the bonus dungeons, and my favorite bonus dungeon get unlocked here, the Whisperwind Cove, which is 40 floors all in random order, except floors 10, 20, 30, and 40, with the bosses of Final Fantasy VI on there. It's a really cool dungeon. Really recommend doing that casually if you ever decide to play this game. And with that, I'm going to be moving on to the starting town. And before we head over there, I guess I'll throw it over to the host real quick for another quick donation.
Yes, we have a €4.20 donation from Mr. Kvicker, saying, Kvicker here. finally arrived at BSG. Hey, Indy. Hey, Reek. Hey, Cruel. Hey, Kinnan. Good luck to all runners throughout the event.
I can't really see him right now, but I guess I'll turn around in a little bit.
So no Wormack on your side?
No Wormack on our side.
Oh, come on, Vox. We have to show them at least one lesson.
We're going to be moving on to a dungeon you may have already seen before, because you might remember this dungeon as the very first dungeon we went into. This is the Chaos Shrine. Now that we've collected the Light of the Four Crystals, we're going to be using that light in order to open up a portal, travel back 2,000 years into the past to fight Garland one more time and put an end to the evil that he's put out. Garland basically being the one to have sent forth the fiends to take the light from the crystals and, you know, kind of block us in our path. But here we now open up a portal, we're going to step 2,000 years back, and we're going to end this once and for all. So normally I'd say there would be very hype music here, but I won't be able to hear that until they get in here. Which is a little unfortunate, but so be it, I guess. Also, on that note, Zeta, though it might not officially count, I think this would have been a PB for you if we don't get really trolled in this dungeon, wouldn't it?
Yep.
So, unless it would take me like 15 plus minutes to get through here. On average, this dungeon takes 11 minutes, so it's not that long a dungeon. It's definitely one of the longest dungeons in the game. I think the only one being longer is Cavern of Earth, and even that's debatable. This dungeon contains 6 boss fights, the first one actually coming up right here being the Death Eye. Now, the Death Eye really doesn't have a lot of health, which you'd think makes this boss very easy, but he actually has a ton of defense. And for the first time, we're actually going to be using that loot that we got about like 3.5 minutes into the game. Because this is going to open up the portal towards the lower floors. And well, with that, it's onto the next bit. One boss down, a bunch more to go. I didn't really need to save here, but I was in the menu anyway. Box pretty much making quick work of Tiamat right now. With that, he is about to get his last crystal and also going to be moving on to the final dungeon. The dragon zombies can still be kind of useful in that they have a very rare drop being the Mega Elixir, which is very useful for the late game, actually. We're not going to get it. That's kind of unfortunate. It's a very rare drop. You don't usually see it, but it makes the final boss a lot safer. And then Chaos Shrine, the first floor, actually the dangerous floor in this one, in that these white dragons, if you get ambushed by 4 and they all use Ice Storm, they can still very easily kill you. Other than that, we're about to get to a big drop in difficulty, actually. Once you hit the lower floors, we're going to get some enemies that we found in earlier dungeons, meaning that they will be significantly weaker than what we've been fighting in here. Last white dragon. Let's see if we can get away. And that gets us pretty much into the clear. Chaos Shrine B1, and this is where we're going to be doing a boss every single floor. From this point on, every floor will have a boss fight at one of the last tiles before moving on to the next one. And then on the fifth, on B5, we will find Chaos or Garland himself. Being the final boss of the game, so it's basically a home stretch from here.
Box just entered the Chaos Shrine. Just a few minutes behind, but still anything can happen.
Oh, absolutely. The final boss is not a safe fight. I will mention the thing you see unlocking on Box's end, that's actually the fifth and last bonus dungeon, the Labyrinth of Time, which actually has a separate category in and of itself as well. The Labyrinth of Time is a miscellaneous category in that this is a dungeon where it kind of intends you to solve puzzles as fast as possible. You need to disable certain abilities, and that will allow you to get into the dungeon or to get into a puzzle, and then if you are at that puzzle, you have a certain amount of time to solve it depending on which abilities you locked off. It's a pretty cool concept, definitely one to try out yourself sometime. Most runners don't usually go there, and most old bosses runners hate it. Encounterless nice. First floor for on boxes and nice. I just and, got rid of the Lich, which you may have remembered as, you know, the first actually major boss of the game. A quick note on the enemy that Box is fighting. The Ice Kickers Winter Wolf will actually only go down to a Judgment Staff from the White Mage. The Black Mage will not be enough to kill the Ice Kickers, which is why he opts to just go for that one.
Also, another quick note on the Lich fight. The second Lich isn't as deadly as the first one, but he also knows a spell that's called Flare, and which can make a lot of damage. It usually won't kill you.
Now, at the health that I was at, it would have probably killed everyone but my warrior. It was very likely that my white mage would not have survived either, but it's, you know, there's no way to tell at this point. But Flare is basically that spell that we've been using with the Judgment Staff every single time. Really, really powerful black magic spell. That, for me, is the second refight done. Box now starting the first of the six bosses in this dungeon. So, you know, just a couple floors behind, and like I said, a lot can still happen, especially this floor right here, the Kraken floor. It has an unrunnable encounter, the water elementals. I've actually had it happen that I got this floor completely encounterless. I've had that happen twice. Once, actually, right here at BSG. But other than that, you're hoping to just not get them. I got lucky in getting them with a water naga, which makes them runnable still. Box using his loot to unlock the path into the lower floors of this dungeon as well. And it looks like I got a good Kraken floor in that I didn't actually get any unrunnables. And that's generally what you're aiming for on this one. So the Kraken not going down in one turn. This is a range on whether it goes down in one turn, I believe. I think if you get basically all crits, you can kill them that fast. Although I'm not 100% sure on the exact numbers. However, starting the next boss, we will see a bit of a change in strategy. Because for Tiamat himself, we're actually going to be starting to use Haste for the first time. That's basically the Tiamat fight is, if you just attack, it's about a 50-50 whether you get a 2-turn or a 3-turn. However, by using Haste on the ninja, the odds of getting a 2-turn basically increase enormously to about like 90 to 95%. So it becomes a significantly more consistent fight. If the Haste goes off before the ninja, you're basically guaranteed to get a 2-turn. If it goes off after, it's not guaranteed, but the odds are still very, very high. That should do it. Yeah, there we go. Even got a hit to spare on the white mage, so looking good on this one. And with that, it's one last stretch. I will note that this floor right here actually has a unique 1 in 64, which makes it a really annoying floor for the full bestiary category. But other than that, it's basically chaos left. So we're going to heal up. I'm going to do some menuing to make sure that I have all of the equipment I need. Specifically, we're going to get the golden staff. And one thing you may have noticed is I actually equipped the clothes on my armor. Reason for this being that I want my white mage to be... my white mage to be slower than chaos. And with that, it's onto the final boss. And, you know, at the 130 mark, pretty much exactly, going into the final boss, this fight is about like 2 to 3 minutes. So pretty average time still for a race. And... considering how this went, pretty good run. Definitely something to be happy about. Box now currently on the Merilith floor, so he's right behind me. This boss can kill me, so it's definitely not done yet, which is why we saved before the boss fight. I'm going to go for a bit of a weird strat. I'm going to actually use a Giant's Tonic on the White Mage, considering my health, so that might actually be the safer route here. Basically, if the white mage gets a crit on this health, she will die. And that is basically just GG right then and there. I've actually once lost world record to that happening. Being, like, at that time, like, a good minute ahead. Which was very painful, I will say. So we get the Blaze. Chaos can do a couple of things. He's got two different magic cycles that he cycles through. One of which being the bit of a tougher one, Blaze Tsunami Cyclone, which is the one he just used, as well as some less damaging spells like Blazaga and the likes. And then he can also just go for physical attacks. But yeah, he's going for the really tough spells here. I think my Black Mage should survive this, but if he goes for a Cyclone next turn, that might become an issue. The same goes for my Ninja, for that matter. I'm getting pretty low on health. I'd like a physical, and especially not a Cyclone right now. Get ready on the timer, by the way, because I am not very far off. Ugh, he goes for the Cyclone. This could be an issue.
I mean, you're still ahead, so you can reset.
Yeah, but I don't think I'm going to reset. I think I'm going to try and salvage this fight. Ooh, the ninja dying, but the Black Mage tanking it on just 16 health. That means that we should still be able to get him done. Earthquake is basically immunity. That's a free turn. That gives me the health that I need in order to win this fight from here on. So it's pretty much GG at this point. Thank you, Zeta, for running with me. Thank you, Box and Indy, for racing against us. It was definitely an interesting match. And as we finish this off, get ready on the timer. There's that crit on the White Mage, by the way. That would have killed her had I not used the Giant's Tonic. Okay, I kind of expected that to kill. It's probably next turn.
In before Kuraja.
Nah, there's still a slow in between, which I haven't seen yet. So Kuraja shouldn't be happening. But having the ninja is basically the biggest damage dealer here, so having the ninja dead loses quite a bit of time. I'm running really low on magic on my White Mage. Time. I'll shake your hand when you're done as well, Box. But yeah, that is Final Fantasy 1, any percent for the PSP. It's been a while since we last saw it at a BSG, but to race it in such a setting was definitely a lot of fun. Yeah, let's cheer for Indy and Box getting into the last stretch.
And the last random encounter is an ambush.
And the last random encounter being the random, the air elemental ambush, which definitely generally gives a good idea of what their run was like. Yeah. Just ambushes all round.
And this encounter is not very generous.
Looks like Box is going just to go for the Judgment Staff. Doesn't want to deal with this any more than he needs to. And he should be going into the final boss here very soon as well. Does not get the kill with the Black Mage, which is actually kind of interesting. I thought that would kill as well.
Yeah.
Woo! Right. Yeah, again, like it's about a 3-minute fight and Box is about 5 minutes, so we should be fine in getting this done as well. Again, he's going to be equipping the Golden Staff as well as the clothes. Make sure that his MP is on full.
Clothes?
Yeah, don't forget the clothes, Box.
This might could be a bit difficult then.
So we got the save on Box's end, and with that, it's time for him to also do a refight against the very first boss of the game. He really is still a scrub, after all. But he just has a little bit more health and all that, and he learned a couple of spells, but he really is still the scrub that he was at the start of the game.
But we already killed Gallant, but this wasn't even his final form.
This wasn't even his final form. Fantastic. So there we go on Box. He's going to, from the looks of it...
Definitely a Giant Sounding on a Black Mage.
Yeah, he might opt to go for the Ninja as well for some safety. I personally would, but I considering... Yep, looks like Box is going to opt for the slightly more risky strat. It might very well pay off, I will say. There's no saying that it wouldn't. Blaze on turn one is generally not necessarily bad. It's kind of the spell that you don't like seeing, but it also won't kill anyone. It gets the mage very low, though. That's kind of normal that the black mage gets that low, but it's still kind of scary, and it can really lose a lot of time if you get unlucky. Gets a full heal on the ninja, though, so at least that is back up to where it should be. Go, it gets a tsunami. This is going to be a painful fight right at the start.
As long as there will be no
cyclone. It kind of seemed like the fight
turn
that we had as well. The ninja tanking on 8 health. That is very close right there. I really, really hope we'll not be able to... Let's see what Chaos is going to do. He gets the third haste off, but let's see if it's early enough. He gets enough damage in at least. Goes for a physical on the ninja. That should give him the health. From which point on, I want to say this is pretty much GG on Box's end as well. It's basically a hold X to win.
Yeah.
Gets a Blazaga, so he switched over before the Cyclone, which is actually kind of interesting. Chaos doesn't usually do that, but with that, he's going to be outputting like 5k damage a turn, which should get him to a kill pretty close. Chaos has about 20,000 health, which is actually 10 times more than in the original NES version, interestingly enough. There is the Cyclone, but at this point, the ninja should be able to survive this.
Come on, you can do this.
Ooh! Under 3 health! The ninja tanking it on 3 health right there. It looks like the decision for Box to not use the giant tonic does end up paying off. Be it very barely so, and that's time. Good job, Box. Good job, Indy. Very interesting match. Despite a paralock on their end, some unfortunate encounters on both ends, definitely looks like a fun end of the race. Thank you both of the other, or all three of the other runners for joining us on this this idea. Thank you everybody in chat for sticking around for FF1. I believe next up we'll be having SpongeBob SquarePants, which I'll actually be co-commentating. It's my little brother running. Thank you all, and I'll be back tomorrow for Lufia 1. And I think for all three of the other runners, it's pretty much it for this marathon.
Well, you're going to see us again somewhere, and I just want to quick mention, Blamer 3 may have been won, but... Lava Boost will come back this marathon. I'm gonna make it. Trust me.